Zenzenina, 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 Zenzenina.
Tell me what I am.
I'd like to know the truth.
Everybody can see that I'm a colored person.
How dare you say you're colored? You're black.
We aren't black, we aren't white.
We used to be called poor whites.
We don't know who we are and where we come from.
Am I a colored? Am I a European? Am I an African?
You lack a specific identity, we lack a culture.
You are not a somebody, you are just mixed.
Where the whole history of people were uprooted.
It's a community that's forgotten.
Shoved to the back of the line.
It almost seemed that apartheid is going into reverse.
We're still waiting for our turn. Our turn. Our turn.
The only sin is the color of our skin. The only sin is the color of my skin. The only sin is the color of my skin. The only sin, the only sin is the color of my skin. Oh, 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 yeah.
My identity is cast in stone. I'm not ashamed of who I am. I'm walking in the freedom that my father gives. I'm a child of Africa. Different shades, different colors we may be. That's the beauty of it all. We are one in our diversity. A perfect picture in God's eyes.
We are African, mm-hmm. Children of the mother.
Say again,
children of Africa.
Open your mouth, let the whole world know. There we go.
After 1994, all of a sudden, for the first time, the ANC government informed us that we were colored. And it was a shocking revelation that for all these years during the struggle, we thought that we are black and our destiny lies in our redemptive blackness.
When we arrived in 95, we were coached to say that Americans doesn't know what a colored means. We should only tell them that we are black. For us coming from the era of apartheid and being free, it was again a denial of who we were. But honestly speaking, we didn't know who we were.
Are we in fact a pure group of people coming from a descendant of colored people, if you want to call it that, or people of color, as opposed to being a combination of black and white people? I think that's most probably one of the key things in terms of identity that I think we need to understand.
It was Europe's need for spices that eventually led to the discovery of the Cape of Good Hope. In the mid-17th century, the Dutch East India Company, also known as the VOC, wanted to build a station halfway between the Netherlands and the spice lands of the East. The company chose a navigator by the name of Jan van Riebeck to lead this mission. His orders were to build the station for the sole purpose of making profit, as the VOC had no desire to colonize or develop the Cape. Yet they stayed. They settled, cut ties with Europe, and eventually called themselves Afrikaners. And it was with van Riebeck's arrival at the Cape in 1652 that would change the landscape of South Africa for centuries to come.
It just so happened that the Cape of Storms lived up to its true name. And these ships accidentally landed up in Table Bay. they were uncertain as to what sort of inhabitants were at the Cape at the time. The captain, Jan van Riebeek, sent in a group of his own men to explore to see what sort of inhabitants there were, to create some sort of liaison with whoever is here.
Van Riebeek's crew was met by local natives, the Khoi Khoi, also known as the Khoisan people. They largely, if not exclusively, inhabited the west coast of southern Africa until 200 to 300 AD, at which time the more historically notable Xhosa and Zulu tribes were first migrating south from central Africa. They were a light yellow-skinned semi-nomadic people whose cattle and livestock were at the core of their livelihood. The Khoi had no fixed claim to their land and grazing areas, therefore they were easily appropriated by the VOC. And once these lands were gone, the Khoi clans quickly collapsed.
So the Khoi would just say, look, they were not hostile people, they were not militant in nature, they would just move on and just look for alternative ground to graze their cattle.
Within a short period of time after the VOC's arrival, these most indigenous of all South Africans, the Khoisan people, died by the thousands. The few who survived had no choice but to turn to the white farmers and become part of the laboring class. And it was at this time in history where the colored community was born. Dutch men would intermix and oftentimes marry Khoi women and slave women who were being shipped from Africa and the East. The Khoi eventually assimilated into European culture, and their identity as a tribal people was lost. Today, only their genetic DNA footprints have survived.
And there were in the whole history book of about 400 to 500 pages, there were barely 2 pages committed to the history of slavery.
In March of 1658, the first slaves arrived at the Cape on board the Amersfoort. Upon their arrival to Table Bay, slaves were given new surnames, which oftentimes reflected the name of their new Dutch master, or a biblical surname such as Adams, Davids, Peters, or Jacobs. Many Capetonians today still possess surnames that reflect the month in which their slave ancestors arrived at the Cape, such as January, April, September, and October. Unlike the slave trade to the Americas, slaves were transported in small numbers, sometimes in groups as small as 10 or 20, from various Asian and African countries. Genetic DNA testing has found that many Capetonians share a common ancestry with African Americans.
During the building of the first castle, Zachariah Wagenaar engaged the project, and he needed these artisans who were familiar with and professional in building a project of this means. So he looked to the east where various ships had visited the Cape, conveying various artisans to Europe, and he felt that that was an opportunity to bring these builders and plasterers and carpenters from the east to the Cape.
Many of these new artisans brought from the east were Muslim political prisoners from other Dutch colonies around the globe who were serving out their prison sentences, many of whom were royally ranked in their respective countries. They too would become slaves, suffered under Dutch rule, and would become known as the Cape Malay community in the Western Cape. The Castle of Good Hope took 7 years to complete. This amazing structure, built by the slaves, has become the foundation of Cape Town history. With the influx of so many cultures arriving at the Cape, the slave community struggled with cultural cohesiveness, nor did they share a common language.
They formulated a new language which confused their masters. It was known as Kanala Town or Kanala language, and this was a mix of Dutch, a bit of English, and a bit of their own little spice which they added to it, which was only shared amongst the then slaves and prisoners alike. And this language has prospered and kept its stead through time, and today we know it as Afrikaans.
Afrikaans, Afrikaans.
Sy liefde is wonderbaar vir my. Sy liefde is wonderbaar vir my. Sy liefde is wonderbaar. Hy sterf op Golgotha. Sy liefde is wonderbaar vir my.
Slavery at the Cape endured for 180 years, and the VOC controlled the Cape of Good Hope for 140 of those years. Bankrupt, confused, and beset by powerful nations competing for the same resources, the VOC would not survive. Great Britain recognized this weakness and saw an opportunity to control this lucrative and strategic port before it fell into the hands of Napoleon. British forces landed at the Cape in 1795 and took control from the VOC. They would remain in power for most of the 19th century. And with British rule came the abolishment of slavery.
1834 signaled the very first freedom for all slaves. It was not very well received by any of the masters at the time, which is understandable, because that meant that the cheap labor option was no longer an option.
After a four-year apprenticeship program, the slaves were finally free in 1838. And with their newfound freedom came a mass migration from the farmland to the city, where they would dwell on the foothills of Table Mountain, then called Kanaladorp, which was later renamed to District 6.
When I was in school, 1958, it was in Standard 8. You can imagine how far back I'm going. The history then, we were taught was the Boer Oorlog, between the English and the Boer.
Soon after the slaves were freed, the Afrikaners felt that their way of life was being threatened by British occupation. They left the Cape in large numbers into the interior of South Africa, which was known as the Great Trek. This mass exodus would not shield the Afrikaners from Great Britain's dominance for very long. In the late 1800s, the fierce Anglo-Boer Wars took place between the English and the Afrikaners. During these battles, the British set up concentration camps across South Africa, where some 30,000 Afrikaner women and children died of malnutrition and starvation. This was a devastating blow to the Afrikaner psyche, and the anger over the death of their families would eventually, in various ways, lead to the institution of apartheid.
Then the Afrikaner decide never again they will allow themselves to be oppressed. Mm. Understand? And then they form the National Party. Then there was the help of the colored people. They voted to support the National Party because they were promised that our people will be looked after when it comes to housing, land and whatever, and have privileges given to them if they vote and support the National Party. And that's what they did, and believe and trust the white man. And then when they had the power, they set into law certain things that will always favor their people, protect their people. That's how apartheid, out of fear and out of oppression, came about.
The National Party eventually gained their independence from the British in 1948 with the national election of D.F. Malan.
Actually, Dr. Malan is in his own particular white world. He's quite a nice old gentleman. But when he comes into the world of race, when race morality becomes his supreme morality, which it is, that's what apartheid is, it's race morality, then he will take any step whatsoever to ensure the supremacy of his own people.
Immediately after taking office, the National Party began to impose laws that would mold their idea of a perfect society, which became known as petty apartheid.
I feel confident that the Bantu leadership of Africa, rural and urban, will, by the turn of next year, show in a most marked way that they are satisfied that this policy leads to their salvation.
The first set of laws to impact the colored community were the Prohibition of Mixed Marriages Act, which banned marriage between the various race classes, and the Immorality Act, which made sex between the different race classes illegal. These two acts alone would literally nullify and denigrate the existence of the colored people. The Afrikaner, who some 250 years earlier created this community by intermixing with Khoisan and incoming slaves, were now implying through law that the colored people and their way of life was not valid, that they are illegal. Another string of laws in the 1950s began the process of racially defining and physically separating the various racial and ethnic groups. The Population Registration Act divided people into three race classes: white, black Bantu, and colored. A white person was defined as one who is in appearance obviously white and not generally accepted as colored, or who is generally accepted as white and is not obviously non-white, provided that a person shall not be classified as a white person if one of his natural parents has been classified as a colored or a Bantu. A black Bantu was defined as a person who is generally accepted as a member of any Aboriginal race or tribe of Africa. A colored person could fall into one of seven subcategories, all of which had their own place or caste in society. This was the only race class that was so ethnically detailed by the apartheid government. A fourth race class, Indian, was added later. East Indians were brought to South Africa in large numbers in the mid-1800s as indentured servants. Their political contributions under the leadership of Mahatma Gandhi helped change the face of politics for people of color all across South Africa. Now that the National Party had defined on paper the various race classes, a plan was needed to legally carry out the actual classifications amongst the people. As South Africans queued up to apply for housing, they were oftentimes met by a young white government official who would determine their fate.
Which may seem amusing, but rather humiliating incidents had occurred in our country when the Department of Census started reclassifying people. They hauled people with the trams in the mornings out of the bus queues and took them up to the Native Commissioner's office. And some of the tests applied to tell a man that he was not colored was trying to pass a comb through his hair. Other people whose noses were a bit flat were told, you're not a colored.
For instance, my brother is married to a girl that's classified colored. Her brother is white. Mm. So there are four kids, two white, two colored. They were classified by their photo. So she would look at the photo, this brother looks white. Her photo would come up colored. And families, and that is why up until today,
Families were separated.
Living, so you can live on that side of Rondebosch, but not on this side of Rondebosch because you're railway line. And so the one brother cannot visit his sister. And this is the truth in this instance now with my brother.
My family was the same.
Another law was put into place, the infamous Group Areas Act, that specified particular areas or homelands that could only be occupied by the members of these newly defined race classes. But implementing these divisions would be difficult, as there was a good mix of cultural populace in Cape Town. The act led to a massive relocation of blacks and coloreds to townships far away from the city center. One such relocation struck at the heart of the now cohesive community of District 6.
Now this is the heart of District 6, Cape Town. As I'm standing here and looking at the buildings, and I am trying to figure out where did we stay. But I have a good idea
just behind the church there, where that big building, which is now the Technicon, is standing, right where that big building is, that is where we stayed. My thoughts are going way back when I was a little boy staying in this area. How wonderful it was, the loving people in District 6.
At its height, District 6 was home to approximately 60,000 people. While one might describe it as a slum, it was the fabric of life for the colored community. It was a representation of what the white government proclaimed could not exist between the race classes: harmony. And in 1966 came a death sentence, the one and only symbol of their colored culture and identity, a place of racial and religious harmony, a place seven generations deep, dating back to the slaves, was now legally declared a white-only area.
What happened in District 6 also happened in Sophia Town, where people were forcibly removed, where the whole history of people were uprooted.
Actually, what really happened was all the good areas were given to the white people. They didn't want us near to the big centers, near to town, and they felt we have to live one side, and they have to live on their own, because maybe they thought we weren't good enough for them. I think that's the main reason, because we were of a different color, a different class, and maybe they thought we were of a lower class. And those things still hurt, and it still brings pains into your life. Because I know what it's like to be moved out of a house. It's not a good thing, it's not a happy thing, it's a very sad thing, and it stays inside of you.
One can imagine why the whites put us out of District 6. Look at the sightseeing here, the dockyard, the blue sea, and look at the whole place is surrounded with mountains. But you know what is the amazing thing that I can't understand? Why are the lands still lying the way it is? Just our houses have been dropped. Look where we're staying now, way out of Cape Town. And I don't know what went through the minds of these whites. And sad to say, it almost seemed that apartheid is going into reverse. I hope it will not happen. I hope that the colored people will come alive, and that somebody will know that we have to restore our dignity. Beautiful Cape Town, where are your beautiful people?
In the years prior to Nelson Mandela's election, the colored community in the Western Cape was an integral part of the struggle to abolish apartheid. Yet very few recognized their contribution.
Even in the history books, they try to minimize or even cancel our role in the struggle. Mm. And we played a major role. And we had leaders like Neville Alexander that spent as many years on Robben Island, and many of our people.
Then we couldn't take it anymore, and then we made up people to fight against the white man. Now, I was one of them. That time, it was freedom fighters. Today, it's the comrades. I was nearly locked up for taking on colored people's part. Even in the train, it used to be Europeans only. And then I get my men, ladies together, come, we break that law. They send soldiers. And now one of the soldiers is in the train and it pierces it in your back or in your leg, and then it hurts because it's a bayonet. And then fear creeps into them. And then the head of the police force will come and ask who is in charge. Everybody is quiet. Now I, as a comrade, will stand out and I will tell him, whoever's in charge, lieutenant, Captain, I'm in charge. Now, why do you lead your people to take over this coach and it's written on Europeans only? Then I said, Europeans only. Now you look at me. Am I a colored? Am I a European? Am I an African? Tell me what I am. I'm a human being just like you are. If I look at my color, then I look much fairer than what you as a white man is.
Do you find any conflict between apartheid and Christianity?
No, certainly not. Our experience is that these people prefer to be left in their own churches. As a matter of fact, there are 9 different non-white churches belonging to the Dutch Reformed Church. There are instances when we come together on a higher level in conferences and sometimes also in their churches.
I remember with the denomination, I was a part of the full gospel
denomination.
You were the AFM, you were the Assemblies of God. Yeah. And I tell you, we came up against those white denominational moderators and those men, and we were warned.
It's always a threat.
And we had a choice. Either you're thrown out of this denomination and your license is taken away from you, you shall never preach again in South Africa. And they had this power.
We were at a conference up in Barumbat, and I served on the national leadership. I was the only black leader, part of that leadership. And so one by one, we went around, and so each one gave his story, and most of the guys had double passports.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
British passports.
British, yeah, that's it, yeah.
And they were then saying, look, my family is going to provide for me. And they went around, and eventually, when they came to me, they suddenly realized, whoops. And they said, well, Roger, what about you? I said, well, my passport will just take me to Robben Island. So guess what, guys? I have to stay. I then realized at that juncture, I could never again look to a white man for leadership in South Africa. Because at a critical part of our nation, all of them were ready to leave.
They were ready to leave. They had their British passports, all visas, everything ready.
With many of their church leaders now gone, they continue to fight on their own. International sanctions forced the National Party to rethink their apartheid policy. Despite hundreds of years of slavery and psychological oppression, a new fear was arising in the Western Cape. And just months prior to the first ever democratic election in South Africa, there was a sudden turn of events in the Cape Colored community.
People need to understand why our people were so gullible to vote for a party that oppressed them through the years. The media was run by the whites, and our parents were brainwashed that they must be scared for the black people. We were brainwashed through television news and newspapers. There was no other channel of communication that came to our parents. Our black brothers and sisters, whom we love and respect, and we have got no conflict on with them. But somehow, because of 1994, they think that
we are the threat.
We are threat and we move with the whites, you understand?
Yeah.
But it's not like that.
It's not true.
It was because of ignorance that our people, the majority, although we voted ANC, but the majority of our people, because of fears and insecurities.
Nelson Mandela and the ANC party won the national election by a landslide. The only area in which the ANC did not win was in the Western Cape and Cape Town, which was later nicknamed the election Nelson Mandela lost.
I don't know if this is a deliberate ploy of the ANC, but under books we registered as blacks, but when it comes to the execution of the policies of the ANC, we're not black enough.
I vote ANC knowing that maybe someone will recognize me now, because, I mean, after all, I am black. And to my disappointment, really, things didn't work out the way I pictured in my mind.
In March of 2005, the government passed the Affirmative Action Plan, BEE, Black Economic Empowerment. Its purpose is to promote and achieve equality in the workplace. However, definitions of this new policy have been confusing.
I think the South African government at the present moment are heavily relying on, even though they would not admit it, they heavily rely on the terms and the definitions that emerge from the apartheid regime.
When you talk about black, this is for blacks, yeah. Define. Yeah. Because I don't understand when you say this is for black black people. Because when we have to go to universities and there's certain position there, they say this is for a causa speaking black.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And and then I ask myself, now they say I'm black. So we need really need to define when somebody say you're not white, you're black. I want to know why. And I don't know where affirmative action fit in, because affirmative action doesn't work for us. Mm. It only works for the black man.
Yeah.
It doesn't work for us.
No, it doesn't work for us. We're not black enough. We're not black enough. The word,
But in the part that is, we were not white enough.
The local Cape Town government does not actually actually fairly represent the colored community in Cape Town. It is predominantly catering for the interests of the white community, even though they have been put into power by the colored votes.
Well, the people that's supposed to speak on behalf of us do not really understand, because they've never lived in a colored township. They don't understand what we've gone through as colored people.
There's never really been anybody strong emerge that stands up for the colored people.
The weakness in our colored people is we do not stand together. We rather condemn one another.
Ignorance, on behalf of Western media, has kept the colored people in the dark. Foreigners who come to invest in the disadvantaged communities of South Africa have no idea that there are millions of people living in colored townships. Thus, the colored community rarely benefits from international investments and donations.
If you ask any foreigner, they don't even know that there's colored people. They don't know about colored townships. And I was shocked.
Look, I mean, there's nobody looking at the well-being and at what we need. For instance, in our townships, you don't get new HIV/AIDS centers, you don't have recreational facilities, you don't have rehab centers. There's no new initiatives from government side. There's no initiative from business side. So what's been happening is capital and money is flowing out of our communities, but nothing is coming back.
The black man rules the land. The white man owns the land. But where is the land of the colored man?
You cannot go to Zululand and buy land there as a colored person. You've got to be a Zulu. And so all of that land that was given by the state, it was given to them. It was given to the chief. He can give it away to any of these tribes. We don't have access to that ground. Yet they can come into Cape Town and they can buy ground.
There's something different in Cape Town, because the colored people has always been in the majority. Working class people in the new setup are now feeling threatened because of the influx of a lot of people, particularly Xhosa-speaking people from the Eastern Cape, who are leaving the Eastern Cape and move into the Western Cape because of a better life for everybody.
We should be concerned about the tension between colored and black people. You see, our country is being run by a predominantly black political party that stands for the advancement of black people and their causes, which is right. But in a country like ours, you have to look at all the different races. Colored people can be very racist at times against native black people, where we feel that they don't really belong in Cape Town, that Cape Town is originally meant for the colored people. Because nobody's dealing with this, with racism, especially on school level, my fears are that our children will bear the brunt for us not talking about these things.
I think the worst dilemma facing the colored community today is
people dealing with an identity crisis because we aren't black, we aren't white, we're somewhere in between.
One day, a friend of mine who happens to be a Zulu, we were in discussion and he said to me, Yapi, why are you guys always referring to yourselves in negative terms? I say, what do you say? He said, because, like, so-called colored. I said, no, because I am black. And then he said to me, you know, I'm also black, but I am a Zulu. And that day I realized for the first time in my life that even though I am black, which is a state of mind for the struggle, a state of mind for the whole question of affirmative action, but deep down in my heart, I'm mixed. I am a colored person.
So everything that was a little bit white, a little bit more fairer, a little bit more like to be white, I think it's what they call the slavery mentality.
In my childhood, I remember being ostracized by other kids. We used to be called poor whites or wannabe whites. It was difficult to deal with because I didn't choose to be the person that I am. I didn't choose my color. I never chose my descent, and it was difficult to deal with.
Some of us are, you know, black as colors. Some are more white than even some white people, and we have colors. And some is just in the middle, brown people. They used to call us brown people to brain mensa, but really they started calling us colored people. Today I feel a bit different about the word because it tells me, it reminds me where I come from. And I don't forget my background. I would have loved to be called just a South African or just another black person. But if you think of black, you think of black in the color of black. And I'm really a colored person. And yeah, I have my reason probably why I sort of don't fight so much today to be called a colored.
Personally, I hate the word colored. I don't like the word colored because, again, it is a derogatory term. It is something that we didn't decide upon. It is something that people decided to give to us. I don't see the reason why you have to define somebody. At this moment, I think it's important to have this definition because our people is marginalized economically and politically. So for now, I think it's an important tool to use to uplift our communities and develop our people.
She said, look, at university, they asked me, what are you? And I said, I'm a colored. And they said, the colored is not a people.
Oh, my goodness.
You know what I'm saying? And I started pulling out books of Adam Koch.
Okay. Yeah.
Because that was now leading me to my people, which is the Khoi people.
That's right.
You know, and I started studying that. I read that book, and I came back, and I said, listen, baby, here's a book for you. You start reading that book. And then she, of course, went back to school.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the question was raised again. She says, no, I'm a Khoi.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, everything changed.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, she got respect, mate.
Bennett Greenspan, founder and CEO of Family Tree DNA, graciously donated genetic DNA tests for our cast and crew. These results were not meant to define who they are as a colored culture, but to simply peek into their ancient ancestral background.
One of the reasons why it's so difficult to trace ancestors in our colored community is that our parents never used to keep record of our family's history. They never shared any information with us.
Or our parents were a little bit in, it's not denial, but they were not very proud of the heritage that we have, where we come from.
The one, I want to say niece, she refused to give me information.
Mm.
She said, why do you want to know about my grandmother, which was my grandmother too?
Remember my mother always saying that her grandmother was a Norwegian. Whether that was true, I don't know. But that's all I really know about my mother.
My dad was born out of wedlock, and his mom was a single parent. So I've never met, and he also never met his father.
What I'm seeing in people of my community is the fact that we lack a specific identity, we lack a culture, we don't necessarily have traditions that are unique to ourselves. We're borrowing traditions from some other people. We have food that is generally loved by other people, and therefore we're not adopting that into our own culture. So I think in a lot of ways, I would want to kind of understand, is this because we've never really been a specific or pure group of people, or has it just been kind of the way that we've evolved because of our influences from different entities? So, yeah.
Do we have... Am I an African? That's important. Do I come, do I have people from Europe? I don't really care about them, but do I have? If not, that's fine.
I don't know what to expect.
It's like, almost like, is my name in the book of life? Oh, man.
Why do you want to know? You know, what can that help you? And I think that it when you know where you come from, you sort of know where you're going. I know it sounds a bit corny, but to me, that's the way I feel.
My father, because he was very fair of complexion, and his mother told me, my grandmother, that his father was a white man. So I said, does that mean that my lineage would now go through a white regime that oppresses us like this? I don't want to be a white person. And I started to believe that I'm a Khoi. However, if today's results show that I'm not related to that family, it will give me a new perspective in life.
A guy came up to me and he actually asked me, so what do you call yourself? What are you? And I said, what do you mean? So he asked me whether I'm a colored or a black. So I said, I'm colored. So he said, how dare you say you're colored? You're black. And that sort of confused me. And I that is actually where I started thinking about this whole thing being colored or black. So it will actually be a good thing for me to really know what I am. But according to me, I still think I'm colored.
Yeah. So tell me the results.
Cinematographer William Diedrichs, alongside his wife, receives his ancient paternal DNA results.
Haplogroup A is restricted to Africa, where it is present in several populations at low frequency, but is most common found in populations of the Khoi and Sand tribes of southern Africa. Wonderful! I'm excited. Great. Nice. Wonderful. Good. I knew deep down I'm born and bred here in the soil of Africa, and it's so wonderful to know that.
Haplogroup E3A is an African lineage. It is currently hypothesized that this haplogroup dispersed south from northern Africa within the last 3,000 years with a Bantu agricultural expansion. E3A is also the most common lineage among African Americans. That's why my African American friends like me so much. We are brothers.
Uncertain of her father's ancestry, Jody learns that her father's paternal DNA results stem from haplogroup R1B1C and is of European descent. Jody's father is deceased.
I think it answers a lot of physical questions, like why we look the way we do, but that's just on the surface. But I think, you know, everybody wants to belong to something, and I don't know, it's might seem insignificant to some, but it's kind of important to me. Sorry.
William's wife Desiree and her brother Theodore discover that their ancient maternal DNA ancestry is haplogroup R6, which is descended from Pakistan and India.
This is a huge surprise. This is most probably the first possible thing for anyone's mind in terms of where, what this is.
Dr. Adams receives the news that his father's ancient paternal ancestry is from Europe, haplogroup R1B1C.
I don't know. Do I look like a white? Like a European. Look, I think that it gives me some things to think about. At least I now have an idea. The way I come from.
So I'm an African native here. I'm excited.
I think we need to go to Pakistan and India and find some relatives now.
This is really something, honestly. Wow.
I think I'm definitely going to do my research on these places, so. And who knows, maybe a visit. So, I don't know, that's cool.
At last, now I know where I come from, where I originate from, and that I'm part of Africa and that I belong here. And my roots is in the Khoi and the Sun people. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
The reason why I am so hopeful is because I believe in people. As a pastor, I believe God has put qualities in every person out there. And sometimes because of where I grew up, you know, you feel so inferior that you don't think that God has also put valuable gifts and skills and talents in. And I believe if we can let people see that they are here for a purpose and a reason, and that they can change the situation, they would then get up and improve lives for themselves. That's why I'm so hopeful that I work flat out amongst this community of mine.
This colored community is a mixed race. A race with such a lot of hope. A race that has got such a lot to offer. And it is particularly important for people to understand the struggles, the anxieties, the hopes and the dreams of this people called colored. Some portions of us belong to the white Westerners, some portions of us belong to the black Africans. And that makes us the suitable people to be in the middle, to bring about reconciliation between white and black, and make South Africa a better place for all of us.